Thank you. Thank you all for coming today, and I'm really delighted they serve a free lunch so that we could fill the room. And I'm very happy to be here today for one major reason, and that major reason is bacteria are getting a bad rap in the press these days, and I am not going to stand for it. We've been hearing all these things about E. coli and salmonella and how they're all bad for you. Well, fine. There are a couple bad players, as there are in every crowd. But, by and large, bacteria are our friends. They're good guys. And I want to spend some time today talking about some of the really great things that bacteria do for us. And I'm in a great mood today because it's a post-election day. Woo-hoo. And so I'm going to start off with a cartoon. And this is a Calvin and Hobbes cartoon from years ago, and I'm sorry I couldn't get it in the original beautiful color that it was in. But let me read it to you because the font is really small. The aliens came from a far distant world in a large yellow ship that blinked as it whirled. It rounded the moon and entered our sky. We knew they had come, but we didn't know why. Bright the next morning with noisy commotion, the ship slowly moved out over the ocean. It lowered a tube and drained the whole sea for transport back to their galaxy. The tube then sucked up the clouds in the air, causing no small amount of Earthling despair. With nothing to breathe, we started to die. Help us, please stop, was the public outcry. A hatch opened up, and the alien said, we're sorry to learn that you soon will be dead. But though you may find this slightly macabre, we prefer your extinction to the loss of our job. And then Calvin says to his friend Hobbes, well, that's my science fiction story. Think it's too far-fetched? And Hobbes says, not enough, really. Okay, so you know what to expect for my talk. Let me give you a bit of an outline. I'm going to begin by describing what in situ bioremediation is, and then I'm going to talk about the bioremediation of different sorts of environmental contaminants, including solvents, and then some emerging contaminants that perhaps you've not heard of before. To begin with, something we all know, this is a slide that's going to be obvious to all of you. Yes, water is essential for all of life. Fresh water makes up a small, very small fraction of the water on this earth, even though this is a very watery planet. Most of it is salt water, and we can't use it for many things without treating. Populations are growing, and our freshwater resources are not growing. So this is an important issue for us, especially in this country. 50% of the drinking water in this country is from groundwater. And direct and indirect reuse of water is becoming more and more common. Okay, so what's the problem? That all sounds good so far. Well, the problem is we've got a lot of underground storage tanks in this country. In fact, the most common ones you see every time you drive into a gas station, corner gas stations, they all have at least three, regular, premium, unleaded, you know, all that stuff. There are over 400,000 underground storage tanks in the United States. And our groundwater resources are becoming contaminated. Why? Because there are two types of underground storage tanks, those that leak and those that will leak. Those are the two. Here are pictures, and I'm going to come back in a second, of ones that had leaked and were pulled. You know how the gas stations are closing up every once in a while? They dig those big holes, they pull the tank, they put in a new one, and they go back to business? It's because they're leaking. So when underground storage tanks leak, they leak their contaminants into, oh, wow, it's just the wall, cool, into the subsurface, and then you get a groundwater plume of contamination that moves along, eventually, if nothing happens, hitting groundwater wells and contaminating them. That's groundwater. Our surface water supplies are also under stress because of both direct and indirect reuse. Direct reuse is when we take water, we use it, we then treat it, and we send it back out into the environment where then it is taken up by other folks. Direct reuse is where we do that on purpose. Indirect reuse is where we don't really think about it, like the Mississippi River. Think about the Mississippi River. It's going all the way down the country. People at the top of the Mississippi River, they take the water out, they use it, they treat it, they put it back in the Mississippi water. So when you get down to Louisiana, you want to drink the water? Actually, they do a pretty good job drinking it, treating it. But the point is, indirect reuse is happening more and more commonly in this country. And I'm going to talk about some true ramifications of that in a minute. One potential solution to our water quality woes is called in situ bioremediation. And since many people have not heard that word before, I thought I'd break it down. In situ, very fancy Latin word, means in place. Bio In this case, we're talking about microorganisms. Remediation, method to fix. Microorganisms are fixing one of our problems. So in situ bioremediation simply means using microorganisms to clean up pollution in the environment. We often break in situ bioremediation into different types. The three types I'm going to be referring to today are called natural attenuation, biostimulation, and bioaugmentation. Natural attenuation is the simplest type of in situ bioremediation, and it happens all the time, and it is the reason that we are not all drinking gasoline in our water. As I said, underground storage tanks leak, and I have a gas station that's right up the block from me. Yet, I don't see, in the creek that goes near my house, I don't see water with films of gas on it. Why? Because there are naturally occurring microorganisms in the ground that are near that gas station, so when the gasoline leaks out of the underground storage tank, as long as it leaks slowly enough, then those microorganisms that occur naturally can biodegrade it more quickly than it can move to get to the creek. And that is very good news for us. So that's called natural attenuation. However, sometimes there aren't enough nutrients or substrates in order to promote that sort of activity. And in that case, we need to help the microorganisms along, and one of the means we could use to help them along is by injecting substrates or nutrients. And that's called biostimulation, because we're simply stimulating the organisms that are already there. The third type is called bioaugmentation. In that particular case, the organisms that we need to carry out the reaction of interest are not present in the natural environment that we are trying to treat them in. And therefore, we need to add the appropriate microorganisms. And so we're augmenting the microbial community with new microorganisms. That's called bioaugmentation. Okay. So to show you what a typical in situ bioremediation system might look like, here is a cross view of an aquifer, the subsurface. So that's the surface up there with the trucks and everything. And down here is our contaminated groundwater moving through, and what you do is you dig a series of wells and inject either substrates, nutrients, or microorganisms, whatever it is needed, so that you set up a treatment zone here. As the water then moves through the treatment zone, the bacteria biodegrade your contaminant, and then you get clean water coming out the end. Voila. Okay, that's in situ bioremediation. Any questions? Okay. Next, we'll talk about bioremediation of solvents. So what I'm going to do now is talk about application of bioremediation for a number of different compounds. And let's start, first of all, with the most common groundwater contaminants at U.S. Superfund sites. These are perchloroethene and trichloroethene. Per meaning fully chlorinated, so that's four chlorines. Tri is three chlorines on the saturated carbons. These are both suspected carcinogens. They cause all kinds of problems for us, and we don't want them in our drinking water. Where do they come from? This is the major thing that is used to dry clean this outfit and any other of your outfits that you dry clean. This is the major dry cleaning fluid used in the United States right now. TCE is used for cleaning and degreasing and lots of chemical processing, and both of them are actually used in chemical processing as well. That's the bad news, right? So that's the mean, ugly contaminant. The good news is that we know that there are bacteria that can biodegrade that contaminant. And in fact, under anaerobic conditions, these bacteria are so cool. What they do is they breathe in the chlorinated solvents and they breathe out dechlorinated materials. So they start here with the fully chlorinated one, breathe it in, breathe out TCE. Breathe that in, breathe out DCE, that's dichloro. Breathe that in, vinyl chloride and ethene. That's partly good news. However, it's partly bad news. Because whereas this and this are bad, this and this are worse. In fact, this guy, vinyl chloride with just one chlorine, known potent human carcinogen, really, really, really bad guy. And so if you have microorganisms that are only going to get you part of the way, like all of these microorganisms, they stop, in fact, right there, then we have a problem. Because we're creating something that's more toxic than what we started out with. Luckily, we have discovered a genus, or it has been discovered, that there is one genus of organisms called Dihelicocoides, and try saying that fast 10 times. Dihelicocoides is a very interesting organism, that's what it looks like, and what it does is it's able to dechlorinate all the way to ethene, which is our smiley face over there because it is harmless. We like ethene. The problem with Dihelicocoides is the only thing it can use as an electron donor when it's breathing in these electron acceptors, or at any other time as well, is hydrogen. Hydrogen gas. Oh. So inconvenient to get hydrogen gas to the subsurface. Uses acetate as a carbon source? Okay, that's not such a big deal. I can do that. And then, and it has a variety of different enzymes that it uses to actually achieve this reaction. The other problem with this dehalocoides is we can't figure out what else to grow it on. It grows obligately by breathing in chlorinated solvents. Now, we know this can't be true because we know it exists in lots of different places in the world. And chlorinated solvents have not been around all that long, frankly. And so how the heck did this thing evolve? I don't know. We're working on that. Lots of people are working on that. It's a good question. The other problem with it is it grows very slowly. And in pure culture, it grows very anemically. So we could start up 10 bottles, and maybe 3 of them will actually work. The rest of them will die off. It's very difficult organism to work with. Chlorine gets popped off and turns into chloride. We like chloride. Chloride is non-toxic to us at these low quantities that we're going to find it in. Great question. Okay, because dehalocoides live so poorly by itself, generally it survives in consortia with other microorganisms. And in fact, so here's our dehalo, and it's taking TCE to ethene. The microbial consortia that it lives with include things like fermenters and acetogens. That acetogens generate acetate. Nice name. Fermenters ferment. We all know what fermenters do. And so these guys are producing hydrogen then that the dehalocoides can take, and acetate, and I'll talk in a little bit about vitamin B12. So when grown in a consortia, we can actually get these organisms to be active on the TCE with lactate as a substrate, as long as there are fermenters around to help them out. Okay, so the question of the research was, all right, how do we then optimize bioremediation? How can we measure how quickly these guys are growing in the environment, and how can we optimize it? What we want to do is we want to use biomarkers in order to measure the number of dehalocoides in different samples, use quantitative PCR to look at functional genes to figure out what they're doing. Just hold on for a second. I'll explain what these things mean. And then eventually we're going to apply microarrays. What the heck are these biomarkers? Okay, here's a little primer for those of you who have not taken a microbiology course in a long time. And if you're really interested, I teach 114, which is environmental microbiology. We go through this. It's really, really fun stuff. So here is a bacterial cell, one bacteria. Bacterial cell has, as we all know, DNA. It's got the chromosome right there in blue. And on the DNA are individual genes. We've all heard of genes. Well, what happens is the genes do nothing unless the bacteria takes the gene and transcribes it into RNA. So the gene, the white thing, is producing RNA. You get lots and lots and lots of RNA from one gene as long as the bacteria wants to do something with the product of that gene. That RNA then gets converted into a protein, and the proteins are the things that actually do things. DNA and RNA, they don't do very much. But the proteins carry out all the activity. So when we look at TCE or PCE degradation activity, that's occurring because some protein has been produced to make it occur. So if we want to measure things in the cell, we can either measure the cell itself by measuring the genomic DNA, or we can see what the cell is actually doing by measuring RNA. Or if we were really, really cool, we'd measure the proteins. But you know what? Frankly, in my lab, we're not that cool. We're not very good at measuring proteins, so we don't. What we measure is the RNA. Some people measure proteins, and thank goodness those people are out there because it's really hard. Okay, so let me show you what measuring RNA looks like. In this particular case, we're looking at RNA being produced when cells are exposed to the chlorinated solvents. So if the cells are exposed to solvents that they can't degrade, they don't produce any additional RNA, and you see it's flat here. This is copies of RNA per gene and time. And then here we see those three curves that are going up. Those are the solvents that those genes are actually active on. Woo! Well, I got loud and echoey all of a sudden. So you can see that quickly, these are exposure in hours, you get an upregulation that is a production of a lot of RNA in the presence of the solvent. This is showing the decay of those same RNAs. So RNAs are very labile. They get produced and then they disappear. They get produced and disappear. So they're really great for actually showing how active your cell is at any point in time. Whereas DNA doesn't really change numbers in that rapidly. Okay, so that's what we can do. We can do that on all kinds of individual genes. But which individual genes to look at? Well, so what we did was put together a whole genome microarray in order to identify important genes within that culture. What is a microarray? Microarray is a very cool thing. We're using ones from Affymetrix, and it happens to look like this. What it is you put lots and lots and lots of little pieces, tiny little pieces of DNA on chip, and there can be millions and millions of spots on these chips, even though it's a small little thing about this size. So you're able to then look at many different genes simultaneously. And what we did was we designed a whole genome microarray for this particular strain of D. helicoides because its whole genome has been sequenced. So if you know the sequence of the whole genome, you can go in and take individual bits that you know are associated with genes and take little parts of those and make probes for each one of them and place them on that microarray, which is what we did. There are 36,000 probes covering something on the order of 1,600 genes, and lots of matches and mismatches and all kinds of ways to make it statistically relevant. So there's extreme high specificity. In the end, what you have is this microarray here. You take your cells, you can extract either RNA or DNA. You can do it in either case. If you take RNA, you reverse transcribe it to turn it into DNA, and then you label that and put it on the microarray, and you get 1,000 points of light, we like to call it, although it's often 1,000,000 points of light. Okay, so what do results like this look like? Well, in this particular case, I'm really going very quickly through this to give you an overview of some of the types of things we do as opposed to going into depth. I'd be happy to talk to anybody about some of these in depth later on. What is shown here is actually the genome sequence of the strain that we designed the microarray for. And one of the early experiments we did, which I thought was really kind of interesting, was we took a mixed culture that did not have that original strain in it. We took the mixed culture and we extracted its DNA and we queried the chip, and what we saw was the yellow parts here, yellow wedges that are extending outside of the circle, are genes that were absent in our mixed community that had many different species of D. helicoides in them, but not the species that we designed the chip for. And what was interesting to us about it was, yeah, so there's a lot of overlap, there are a lot of genes that were present, but the ones that were absent come in chunks. And not only did they come in chunks, but the chunks looked like they had virus genes on the sides of them to help them be easily inserted and removed. So there's all kinds of interesting horizontal gene transfer stuff going on here. Also, many of these chunks included genes that carry out solvent reduction, which was also piqued our interest. So we wanted to learn more about the basic fundamentals of this organism, so we went back to the pure culture. We said with the pure culture, could we please look at which of the genes are actually being expressed? Because we know it has all the genes, but which ones are it making the RNA for? So the first thing that came up, and what's shown here, is these are the results for the microarray for DCE-exposed cells and TC-exposed cells, two different sets of solvents. And as you can see, there was no real up or down regulation. There was no big difference between those two different solvents. Most of the things were regulated the same, or were expressed the same level. Things that are down here on a plot like this indicate genes that are not really being expressed to any great level at all. Things that are up here indicate genes that are being very, very highly expressed. These are log scales, and so these signals up here are screaming compared to these signals. Okay. First thing is, we looked at the genes that are associated with solvent reductase, or with solvent reduction, that is, with degradation of the solvents, because we wanted to see if all of them were being expressed, and it turns out that a whole bunch aren't even being expressed, even in the presence of solvents. And there are several that are being highly expressed. What else did we find? This was a nice surprise to us. Look at that. Coronoid uptake and recycling. Turns out that this cell is really, really generating messenger RNA for a lot of the B12 uptake and synthesis genes, which suggests to us, we're not giving it enough B12 when we grow it. So the first thing we did when we went back to the lab was throw in a whole bunch of extra B12, and voila, the cells grew more effectively. Carbon fixation. What surprised us was everybody said that these cells cannot fix carbon on their own. And we have not found a way to get it to fix carbon either. Yet, it seems to be producing a bunch of carbon it is expressing a lot of its carbon fixation genes. So that's a question that we're continuing to look at right now. And then finally, it also has a whole operon, the whole thing, for nitrogen fixation, but it's completely turned off. So it's not really, under the conditions we're growing, it's not fixing nitrogen. Nobody's ever shown that this organism can actually do that. So what I want to say about this is the application of microarrays not only can give you valuable information itself, but it also can lead you in new paths and have you ask new questions that you wouldn't have asked previously because you can see which genes are actually being expressed. I want to finish up the solving part by just showing you a couple of plots of field data. So you say, all right, a lot of this is really nice and fancy schmancy stuff, but it's all in the lab, and who cares, because it really doesn't get you to cleaning up the environment. Okay, so what we did was we went out to the field and we looked at a couple of sites where in situ bioremediation was being proposed for the cleanup of chlorinated solvents. And they gave us, we were able to collect data there after they had already gone through the process of applying in situ biostimulation. They went in and pumped in a whole bunch of lactate at both of these sites. And here at this site, you can see we're showing the number of dehalococcoides cells as measured by their gene copies in a bunch of different wells. And in the wells that are close to where they're biostimulating, there's lots and lots of dehalococcoides, so it's happy. And in fact, at this site, they were getting really good bioremediation occurring. As you got downstream where the biostimulation was less effective, you had lower numbers. And then what was really cool was even in the pristine site that was outside of the solvents and outside of any biostimulation, there was still measurable dehalococcoides, which is why this whole thing worked in the first place, because all they had to do was pump in the stimulatory material and the bugs they wanted grew up. At a different site, they pumped and pumped and pumped and pumped, and they never got any bioremediation past DCE. Why? There was no dehalococcoides there. Why didn't they ask us before they pumped and pumped and pumped and pumped? They didn't think about it. If they had, we would have saved them a whole lot of money. Afterwards, they went in and bio-augmented that site. They pumped in some dehalococcoides, and sure enough, they were able to get the solvent to go past DCE. And then to close up the solvent part of this, in a different site where they actually gave us samples prior to doing anything, and then after biostimulation, and then after bioaugmentation, we were able then to track the dehalococcoides numbers as well as a bunch of the reductase genes present at that site. And what this is showing is the purple is prior to biostimulation, so that's background. Red is after biostimulation, yellow is after bioaugmentation, and then the light green is later on down in time. And what I want to point out is TCA was present in the bioaugmentation culture, was present in the bioaugmentation culture, but was not really present at high quantities in the indigenous culture. What this data shows, and we have other data to back this up, was that despite the fact that they went in and bioaugmented, they needn't have bothered, because the indigenous culture was the one that in the end grew up and carried out most of the reaction. The culture that they actually added never really took off and didn't really affect the overall process, which is a real bummer because these bioaugmentation cultures are really expensive. They're like $1,000 a liter. You don't want to make a mistake in making the decision about whether to bioaugment or not. So the conclusions on the solvents. Dehalo-degrades solvents completely to ethylene and chloride. We knew that. Molecular biomarkers can be used to determine when bioremediation will be successful and when you need to bioaugment and when it's not when it is or not being efficient. And then growth of dehalo in simple and complex consortia can be optimized. And these are the people who carried out this work, Patrick and Dave and Kimberly, whose picture I meant to have right there, and Gary Anderson at LBNL, Steve Zinder at Cornell, and Jay-Z, who is at in Singapore. Also, Victor Holmes is an additional person who was on that. Okay, I want to move now into bioremediation of emerging contaminants. Now that we understand the concept of bioremediation, we understand some of the tools that we apply to follow microorganisms that can bioremediate, we can go and look at how one can think about different types of compounds. And, the three that I'm going to focus on today are NDMA, 1,4-dioxane, and PBDEs. I'll show you pictures of each one of those. First of all, why do we call them emerging contaminants? We call them emerging contaminants because they tend to be contaminants we haven't thought about before, either because we couldn't analyze for them, and our analytical techniques have gotten much better. For our old priority pollutants, those are the ones that we used to focus on, gas chromatographs and liquid chromatographs and mass specs used to be good for looking at compounds that were rather hydrophobic. They tended to be mostly biodegradable, and our detection limits were in the parts per million and parts per billion. Now, our equipment is getting much, much, much better, and there are lots and lots of letters up there, a couple of which I'll talk about later, but we tend to put things in tandem now more than we did in the past. We can look at both hydrophobic and hydrophilic compounds, and since we haven't even noticed them previously, we have no idea whether they're biodegradable or not, and we're able to analyze for them down in the parts per billion and in some cases parts per trillion range. Where do these things come from? Wide range of places. We put lots of synthetic chemicals in industrial processes and in products, and I'll talk about some specific ones to them today. Some are consumed by humans and animals, pharmaceuticals and antibiotics that then end up being released into the environment, chemicals that are used in agriculture, and disinfection byproducts that are formed, in fact, by our water and wastewater treatment processes. First one I want to talk about is, this is really cool, N-nitroso-dimethylamine. It is such a long word and such a tiny little chemical. It's a very, 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 very potent human and animal carcinogen, down to the parts per trillion ranges. It has been shown to cause adverse effects. It is really a nasty player. It's a rocket fuel impurity, plasticizer, and solvent. And what we've recently found out, David Sedlak and our group and others have shown, that it is generated by the chlorination of water and wastewater. And so we are generating it and sending it out into the environment willy-nilly. It's regulated at the parts per trillion level. It's hydrophilic, loves water, moves right along with water, doesn't absorb onto things. And it has its low volatility and doesn't, as I said, doesn't absorb well. And as an example, here's an NDMA plume down in the LA basin. It is 7 miles long. 7 miles long. So it moves very easily with water and is not attenuated very effectively. This is from a rocket fuel manufacturing site that was located up here. Remediation options for this. Carbon sorption and air stripping, not effective. UV oxidation is effective, but it's very expensive. And so that brings us to bioremediation. We had a hypothesis. We looked at the chemical, and we said, all right, mammalian studies have been done with them. We know this because it's a known human carcinogen. Anything that's a known human carcinogen, then they've done mammalian studies with. So we looked at how mammals deal with this material. And it turns out that they have this thing called cytochrome P450 monooxidase that oxidizes it and, in fact, activates it and makes it so that it is carcinogenic in your body. Turns out that microorganisms are similar to mammals in that they have bacterial monooxygenases that are similar in function to the P450 monooxygenases. So we said, aha, okay, so if P450s work on them in humans and mammals, then perhaps they also, the bacterial ones, will degrade them. And so we got a whole bunch of different types of bacterial isolates. Here's a big range, I'm not going to go through the names. And many of them had monooxygenases, and some of them had dioxygenases, and then others of them had no oxygenases at all. And we measured the NDMA degradation by all of them. And some are highlighted in green. The green highlighted ones are the ones that were actually able to biodegrade NDMA when they were expressing their monooxygenases. The pink were those that expressed monooxygenases very effectively, but did not degrade NDMA, which told us then that NDMA is biodegraded by some monooxygenases, but not all of them. And then the cells that had dioxygenases and those that had no oxygenases or no mono or dioxygenases were not able to degrade NDMA. So one of the things we were interested in is we were interested to see, I should have pointed out, that the highest activity rates were those that were induced with propane. So we wanted to see if this was a common property. And so my grad student, who loves to travel, traveled around, and he picked up samples in all kinds of different places, and we had some people send us some things. And he brought them all back to the lab, and he added propane to them and enriched them for a short period of time on propane, just so that the naturally occurring microbial communities in those samples that could degrade propane would grow up a little bit. And then he measured to see if they could degrade NDMA. And it turned out that every sample that he took that he enriched on propane was able to biodegrade NDMA. Woohoo! Good news for us. So we wanted to go into some more detail and find out what propane what the propane monooxygenase was like. We found a cell that was similar to one of the ones we had in the lab that had a sequenced genome and that had people who had put together a microarray and were able to produce some knockout mutants for us. And so we collaborated with people at University of British Columbia and Texas A&M, and they put together a microarray and compared pyruvate-grown cells with propane-grown cells of this pure culture of Rhodococcus. And what they showed, what's above this, then, what's above the line are genes that are upregulated in the presence of propane versus pyruvate when the cells are grown on propane. And what's shown right there, the biggest upregulated gene is PRMA, which is a propane monooxygenase gene. So now we've been able to identify it exactly where it is. And we're working with Tom Wood in Texas, who is now evolving that gene to see if he can actually increase its activity. All the rest of these genes are located either on the propane monooxygenase operon or on a dioxygenase operon that I don't have time to go into right now. We wanted to make sure that PRMA was in fact the specific gene and the only gene that was playing a role in NDMA degradation. So we got a knockout mutant of it. That means a knockout mutant is a cell that's exactly like the other cells, but it has that one gene interrupted. You just stick something in it so that that gene can't make its messenger RNA anymore. That knockout mutant was unable to degrade NDMA, showing conclusively that it was that particular gene. So, conclusions from that study, and there's a picture of Josh. I should also have a picture of Chris up here. NDMA can be degraded by monooxygenase-expressing bacteria. Degradation of NDMA to trace levels is possible. I didn't talk about this one today, but it's an important conclusion because NDMA is generally present at low quantities, but we need to drive it down to trace levels. Propane induces for NDMA degradation in both pure and environmental samples. How are we doing on time? Okay. Was that a hand? No, okay. Next compound I want to spend a little bit of time talking about is 1,4-dioxane. 1,4-dioxane is a double ether shown right here. And it's very important to point out so that people don't get confused. It's not dioxin. Dioxane is a double ether, and it is used as a stabilizer for chlorinated compounds, mostly these solvents. It's used also in the manufacture of organic chemicals. It's a probable human carcinogen and with moderate regulatory levels. We had the same hypothesis for 1,4-dioxane as we did for NDMA because, again, from mammalian studies, it turned out that the P450 monooxygenases are active on it. So we tested a whole variety of different strains. It turns out there is one strain, pseudocardiodioxane borans, CB1190 for short, which can not only degrade dioxane, but can grow on it. It uses it as a sole carbon and energy source, which is very cool. Other organisms that express monooxygenases, though, are able to degrade dioxane as well, but co-metabolically. That is, they cannot grow on it. They do it because they can't help themselves, but it gives them provides them no energy. And as I said, we tested a variety of different organisms, and they degraded it over a variety of different rates. We use C14 labeled dioxane to see if the material was actually going all the way to carbon dioxide, was being mineralized, or if it was just being transformed into intermediates that then would become more of a problem. And shown here is the the radial label distribution over time. And you can see the CO2 is the one we're looking for. That's the purple. And in the cells that metabolize it, as well as those that co-metabolize it, the compound is going all the way to carbon dioxide. As it also goes all the way to carbon dioxide in mutants that have a single monooxygenase gene inserted into them. They're E. coli mutants. Abiotic, of course, shows no production of CO2. Finally, the student who's been working on this, Shaley, who's sitting right here, worked out a pathway for the biodegradation of this of these compounds. And this pathway actually looks rather complex and like it has a lot of different pieces and parts. I've talked about this and I've talked about this. She was able, working on a collaboration with Jay Kiesling's lab, she was able to use their very, very fancy piece of machinery there to actually identify every single one of these intermediates. Now, and that fancy piece of machinery, FTICR for your transform ionizing cyclotron resonance mass spec. I think I got it all. And I'll just show you one piece of data from that. And this is one of the intermediate peaks that comes up and then disappears over time. This is a series of chromatograms over time. So that's the sort of data she was collecting for each of those intermediates. Very cool stuff. There's her picture. What we found, the conclusions from that study, dioxane can be both metabolically and co-metabolically degraded by bacteria. And the pathways for both seem to be very similar for both the co-metabolic and the metabolic. The last compound that I want to talk about is a very interesting one. This one is now emerging into the public interest. They are called PBDEs, polybrominated diphenyl ethers. They look like this. There are two circles with an ether in between, and they're brominated. They can be brominated from one bromine all the way to 10 bromines. You've heard this story before. It's similar to PCBs, also 209 congeners. So PBDEs, instead of being chlorinated like PCBs, are brominated. 209 then types. They're very, 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 very hydrophobic. They hate water so much they will absorb on anything, which makes them very difficult to work with. They're known as endocrine disruptors. They're found in air, soil, sediment, sewage, sludge, sea, freshwater. Everywhere they're looking now, they're finding PBDEs, including in animal tissues, in seals, whales, polar bears, bird eggs, breast milk from humans, blood, adipose tissues, everywhere. Why? Where's it coming from, you may ask? And I'm going to tell you, it's coming from here. It is a flame retardant. It's in everything. It's in the carpets. It's in the curtains. It's in this computer. Maybe not. This one's metal. It's in the plastic boxes that cover TVs. It's been impermeated into many, many, many of the products that we buy. And somehow, it is making it into the environment, because it was always thought that they were very extremely inert. Furniture, sofas, building materials, automobiles, all over the place. So we said, okay, PBDs, how might they biodegrade? We looked at the PCB literature, and we realized that PCBs can be dechlorinated, and they're done by certain microorganisms. And so what we did was we got a range of different organisms that are known to be able to dechlorinate things. We said maybe they can debrominate things as well, and did a series of studies that took months and months and months, right, Christian? And what Christian and Zhizhong were able to show is that when you feed the highly brominated PBDEs to bacteria under anaerobic, very strictly anaerobic conditions, they are able to reductively debrominate them down to, these are hexas and pentas and tetras, so they go through a sequential debromination reaction. Good news and bad news. Good news is, yeah, well, you're getting rid of some of them. Bad news, the ones that are moderately brominated, much more toxic than the ones that are highly brominated. And they move more effectively through the environment. So this could be a problem, and it's something that's important to understand. Another problem, you have 209 congeners. How many peaks there do you see? There's no way we could, on the equipment that we had, separate out 209 congeners. Oops, showing the products being produced over time. And so this is a real problem, coelution challenge. That is, many of the congeners are coeluting together, so we can't differentiate them. We can't tell the pathway. We can't figure out exactly what's going on. So what we had to do was collaborate with some guys in Denmark who have this really cool thing called a GCGC, and I'd really love to buy one of these. So if anybody knows of extra equipment money around, let me know. GCGC is a two-dimensional separation gas chromatograph, and it separates in one dimension by one chemical property, and then in second dimension by a second property. It does a cryogenic freezing in the middle so that it can, it's really cool. And so what you do, you end up with is the computer can integrate across peaks, and you get a two-dimensional depiction. And here is the PBD standard showing as many of the congeners separating out as we can actually get. And so by doing this, you can actually get close. I don't think you can get all 209. But then you can do much more careful work, as, for example, as is shown here. This is HEPTA-183. Kristen fed this particular individual congener to a series of cultures, shown three different cultures here, to see which products were being produced. And she found, in fact, that different organisms produced similar products, and I won't go into the details of the different pathways, but let me get right to the conclusions. PBDs can be debrominated by bacteria, known to dechlorinate solvents and other materials. The pathways were similar for all the tested bacterial species that she looked at, and the meta and para positions were removed most easily. That is, they followed a pattern that was similar to PCB dechlorination, which is not surprising, but somebody had to show it. And the overall conclusions, because I want to leave time for questions, is that bacteria are our friends. They are the good guys. They eat lots of our stuff. They save us from contaminated environment. By studying these bacteria, we can learn how to bend them to our will, optimizing their bioremediation activity. And then finally, I hope you will come away with all this with the notion that with all the new types of tools and techniques that we have available to us, environmental microbiology is really, really quite fun. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Alvarez-Cohen. Now we'll ask some questions. Just raise your hand and I'll bring a microphone to you.
So a lot of these abilities are quite young, and you said you're working on trying to figure out, you know, where do they come from? Where do these abilities come from? So do you think it's, we saw that a lot of the cytochromes seem to be somewhat more versatile. Do you think, besides cytochromes, what types of proteins are going to be more flexible and able to adopt new functions to new substrates?
Let me understand. So first of all, I think you're asking about the Dehalococcoides organisms. Is that what you were asking about, or just all of them?
Well, whatever bugs can do now on substrates that are...
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, okay. I see. Yes, I do think that many of these it used to be dogma in environmental microbiology that enzymes were extraordinarily specific. And many enzymes are extraordinarily specific. But we're finding now that there are many classes of enzymes that aren't as specific as we had thought. And therefore, a lot of the degradation of many emerging contaminants, ones that we've only recently produced, I believe are first going to be biodegraded co-metabolically. And cells will eventually, I believe, once they're co-metabolically degrading things, be able to evolve more effectively to then metabolically degrade those same things. And so I think that that's probably how that function will go. But co-metabolism, I think, is going to become more and more important as we have more and more emerging types of compounds.
Any other questions? Yes.
First of all, thank you for the great talk. This is an area totally out of my expertise, so it's fascinating. To what extent are you able to try to anticipate if you were to introduce these bacteria into the environment in levels that they don't previously exist now, what potential implications or impacts outside of the one you're focusing on could be?
Oh, great question. Okay, so like, are the bacteria going to grow up and eat the world? No, I think it's a really good question because... Yeah, I mean, I remember hearing a talk from John Coates a while ago where he was talking about metal-reducing organisms because he does a lot of work with those. And people asked, well, okay, so if you're cultivating these metal-reducing organisms that can go out and carry out these reactions where they make the metals more soluble, will they go and eat, like, the Golden Gate Bridge or something?
That's kind of an extreme example, but I guess on a you know, much more even micro level, if we're going to be increasing, I assume the idea is that you introduce these to areas where they don't currently exist to take care of the gasoline and take care of other problems that we've created. But to what extent do we know that whether or not we might be creating new problems? And it could, you know, the Golden Gate Bridge obviously is, you know, a far-fetched example, but something much more on the sort of microprocess level.
Yeah. So far, there haven't been any cases where bioaugmentation has resulted in increase in functions that were not expected. And I think that what is important to keep in mind is almost every case of bioaugmentation we've ever seen has resulted in the organisms that were added dying off shortly afterwards. So part of the bioaugmentation process is actually changing the environment to favor the organisms you're adding prior to adding them. And the theory is that if the environment was appropriate for those organisms prior to you showing up, they would have grown there. And there's a reason they're not growing there. So you have to adapt that environment to allow them to grow there. And then when their job's done, you stop adapting, let the environment go back to its original state, and those guys die out. None of these organisms that are used for bioaugmentation are known to be pathogens, so the pathogenic issue has not been one that's important. And I'm not aware of any other adverse effects that have ever been recorded from bioaugmentation. And I guess the issue is it's just such a short-term such a short-term effect that they're not going to carry out long-term reactions. It's a good question, though. Uh-oh, John's got a question.
Hi, Lisa. Great talk. Very simply, on the NDMA work, which is really elegant work, what's the lower concentration limit that's being set at the moment for that?
Well, there's a lot of different places that are setting different limits. So there's not an EPA regulatory limit set at this point. There's a California action level, which is 7.7 parts per trillion.
Can the bacteria get it down that low?
Yeah, that's a good question. Yes. We did some studies to see if they could actually scavenge down to below, to the regulatory limit. And we got it to as low as we can quantify, and it could get below that, but we can't quantify below that. Yeah. They're very good at scavenging. And again, I think it's because it's co-metabolic.
So I understand how you could use the, you could apply the bacteria to like the plumes and areas where you had solvents sort of moving through the water system at high concentrations to move it lower. How would this approach apply to the last toxin you were talking about that's in the carpets and just sort of generally in the atmosphere? You don't have a high concentration in one spot, you just have a low concentration everywhere.
Yeah. That's a really good question. In fact, I should have prefaced the PBDE work by saying, in some cases, the bacteria are our friends, and sometimes they carry out reactions we'd rather they didn't. In the case of the PBDE work, what our conclusion was, which was exactly not what we set out to show, what our conclusion was that naturally occurring microorganisms have the capability of debrominating. At least part of the way. And they may debrominate all the way. We don't know this yet. But the reactions are very slow. So what we were showing there was much more of an environmental microbiology process that when you release these things out into, for example, the sediments of the bay, which is one place where they're found in quantity, under the conditions that occur in the sediments, which is very anaerobic, is it possible that they'll be debrominated? And so the answer to that is yes. In answer to your question of how would you apply bioremediation for something like that, the only way I could think of, and it's very inefficient, so I don't think it's a good idea, but the only way I could think of would be to go out and dig up the sediments and put them into a bioreactor to carry it out, and I think that is not a good idea. But yeah, so in situ bioremediation for PBD is right now is not, there's no good concept about how that would work. Thanks for the question.
Excellent, and I think we have time for one more, we're right up at one anyway, so let's give Professor Alvarez Cohen a good hand, and it's great.
Thank you.
That was great. Thank you. You got a lot in there.